So, Pap, I want to talk about something that is gotten a lot of, or I should say, has not gotten very much coverage in the news, but it could be, and a lot of people who follow these things intensely think this is a really pivotal moment with the Obama administration and also what goes on in the Senate. And I'm talking about this past week, President Obama. And it wasn't officially announced, but it was announced that it was going to be announced that President Obama is going to appoint or nominate three judges to the D.C. Circuit Court: Cornelia T.L. Pillard, David Frederick, and Patricia Ann Millett. And these appointees have impeccable credentials. They are considered not necessarily flaming liberals, but they are considered to the left of center, but as
They're
one could
what,
expect.
let me just tell you, they're corporate people, but go ahead.
Indeed, to a certain extent. But what we're seeing here is a very big power play by the Obama administration, or at the very least, that is the speculation. Now, understand that this court, this DC Circuit Court, is really the second most powerful court in the nation after the Supreme Court. And in fact, in some respects, is even more powerful because they hear a lot more cases. This is the court that said that the recess appointments to the National Labor Relations Board was unconstitutional and negated a lot of their decisions. This is a court that has found in favor of a lot of corporate interests, that has gone to curtail the ability of the federal government to do what it needs to do.
Well,
This
Sam, but don't. I mean, I know what you're saying. I mean, I'm hearing that again and again. This is important court. The truth is, he's got about 80 important appointments that he hasn't made.
Indeed.
And why should, can I tell you, I do this, having been a lawyer, and this is what I do day to day. I don't care about that DC court. I care about, courts all over the country where you have trial judges and where you have appellate judges that are still jam-packed full of right-wing troll appointments that were made by Bush.
Right. And well, this
That's,
is one of those courts. And
well,
this is why it's important, because we know that the Republicans have been very obstructionist. We also know that President Obama has not been very aggressive in filling these vacant court seats. Now, the district court has 11 seats, three of which are vacant at this point, following the nomination of one judge just the past couple of weeks. And we know that the Republicans have said that we should shrink this court to 8 seats so that those other three remain vacant, essentially, and move those seats to other courts in the country. And so what we're seeing is President Obama is going to nominate these three judges simultaneously. And this has got to be seen in the backdrop of the failure of Harry Reid to push for filibuster reform in the
Well,
Senate.
okay, Sam, let me
Now,
ask you something. Here's the question I want to pose. See what your reaction to this is. At this point, you got Obama out there flexing his muscle like he can do something. Now, if he can do something here and he hasn't done anything for the last 5 years, buddy, you talk about a huge, huge disappointment for every progressive in this country. In other words, if he could have done it 5 years ago, and he's saying, I can do it now, I don't see any tool that he has now at all that's different. I mean,
Well,
Harry Reid,
there is a difference.
well, if you get a
I'll tell you
filibuster
what.
change, yeah, there's but
Okay,
Harry Reid's
here's what
showing
I am.
he can't do that. He doesn't have the
Here's what some of
backbone.
the speculation of the difference is. Is one, by pushing three nominees simultaneously to this very high-profile court, he is basically daring the Republicans to obstruct them. And because under the deal that was made with Harry Reid,
But they've
that
been doing it
Harry,
for 5 years,
well,
Sam.
but wait a second. This past, in the beginning of this session, Harry Reid made a deal with the Republicans. We will not push for filibuster reform if you agree not to stop judges unless it's under extreme circumstances. Well, the Republicans, of course, reneged immediately on that deal.
On
They have
two
upheld,
very clear appointments that should have been made. Yeah, they just, we're not going to
whether
do
it's
it.
the EPA
Yeah,
or the
exactly.
Consumer Financial
Right.
Protection Bureau or the
Well, they're not, they don't, they love those appointments. I mean, because they're all corporate people, you
well,
know?
or labor. But the point is that they, this is supposedly, and I don't, I guess time will tell, this is supposedly the trigger that in the event that the Republicans obstruct these judges, that Harry Reid will exercise the so-called nuclear option, which basically says that instead of doing this on the day that the Senate convenes for the first time in a new session and sets its own rules, he will midstream, essentially, by a 50-person vote, change the rules in the Senate to change the number of votes that you need to maintain a filibuster.
Okay, why hasn't he done it at this point, Sam? I mean, look, you're talking about
Harry Reid. I don't know
Harry
that Harry Reid had the votes.
He had the votes, Sam.
I don't think so.
He just doesn't have the courage. The guy, he's so outdated. They just need to get rid of Harry Reid, put a young woman in charge, somebody that has some energy and some power and some influence. Get him out of there.
I don't think he had the votes. I think that was a function of a couple of senators who had been there for a long time, guys like Carl Levin, like Dianne Feinstein, who were putting the brakes on this. Remember, I mean, he needs the entire Democratic caucus to walk
across the street and say, you know what, Mr. Levin, if you don't do this, here's what I'm going to do. You got to have some guts to do this. But you got Obama and you got Harry Reid, and you're talking about we got guts there? Harry Reid could have done this already, Sam.
Indeed.
I promise you he could have.
He definitely could have, but I don't think that the votes were there, and supposedly— people like Dianne Feinstein have basically become converts, and this is going to be the showdown. Now, this is speculation, but
you have more confidence in Harry Reid and Obama than I do.
And so these sort of benign and nondescript appointments, I think, may end up being the thing that changes fundamentally
let
the
me
Senate.
Walk,
because,
let me...
look, the Senate has been operating under a so-called gentleman's agreement, and you cannot have a gentleman's agreement with these obstructions.
No, of course not. We've known that. Listen, let me give you a walk through history. December 2010. Democrats controlled the Senate, the House, and the White House, but they Obama not only extended the Bush era tax breaks for the wealthy, he also gave new breaks to the heirs of the super rich. April 2011, Democrat in the White House, Democrat still in the majority of the Senate, Republicans threaten to shut down the government and delay the processing of new Social Security benefits for senior citizens. Democrats went along with the $78 billion in cuts. They cave in. August 2011, Republicans put the United States on the brink, Sam. You remember we talked about it. Brink of falling apart. Instead of invoking the clear 14th Amendment power to honor the nation's debt, which he could have done. Most presidents would have said, hell with you. I'm going to honor the $2.5 trillion. You know, I'm going to honor the debt. Democrats agree to a $2.5 trillion deficit reduction package. They don't have the guts. How about spring 2012, I think. Democrats, they cave in. $4 billion a year given in oil subsidies to the oil companies. You know, Obama caved in on refusing to go after war criminals of the Bush administration, refused to go after Wall Street that destroyed our economy. So why is it that now anything is different? See, that's what I'm having trouble with, you see. They won't even support Elizabeth Warren, Sam. You need more Elizabeth Warrens and fewer Harry Reids, but we don't have that. And this president acting like he's going to somehow do something that he hasn't done in 5 years is a joke. Harry Reid is a joke. This president doing that is just so far-fetched. It's just beyond belief to me.
Well, I think all I got, Pap, is hope springs eternal.
Well, I hope you're right, too, but I got to look at history.
The history I gave, I
didn't make that history up. You and I covered all those stories.
I know, but I still think people should keep an eye on this story. You won't see much talk of it in the corporate media, but that's what we're here for.